Hello, and welcome to SoberCast, where we provide AA speaker meetings and workshops in podcast format. We're an ad-free podcast, and if you enjoy listening, please help us be self-supporting by visiting SoberCast.com, look for the donate link, and drop a dollar or two into our virtual basket. We hope you enjoy the podcast. Have a great day.
As unaccustomed as I am to public speaking, I don't think I can get started unless I introduce myself, as we always do in our AA meetings in Texas. I'm Esther, and I'm an alcoholic. And through following the program of AA to the best of my ability, I was dry 12 years yesterday. But I know this, that the only way that I can maintain my sobriety is to remember always what I was like 12 years ago this weekend. I am shaking like a leaf all over this morning. But at least I know where I am, and that if I continue to do daily what I have done in these last 12 years, I will stay sober till I die. I didn't know that when I came in. I knew that I wanted to try AA, but that it would work, well, I didn't think anything would work. And I think that we have to do time in AA before we realize that it's going to work for us. I wish I could tell you how and why AA works. I don't know. I only know that it does. If you desire it with your whole heart and without reservation. I think that none of us come to AA until we've tried everything we can think of. I know that I had thought if only I had found AA years before I did, that I would have saved myself so much of the shame and degradation of the last few years. But as I've grown in AA, I realize that a person with as much self-will as I had and as hard a head and as diseased an ego, that I had to try everything that I could think of and bump my head up against every stone wall before I was ready to come in. The only thing I have really and truly to offer you is my own story and to tell you just what sort of a drunk I was. It's kind of hard seeing you up here sober and grinning and smiling to think that I was ever in the horrible shape that I was. You know, I came from a family where alcohol was very socially accepted. I lived in New Orleans, Louisiana, and there were cocktail lounges and ballrooms. It was just something that was served openly. I'm an Episcopalian, and we bless our sacraments with wine. I can't remember a dinner at home that we didn't have white wine and claret on the table. There were not cocktails served when I was growing up. I think the family used to drink sherry every now and then, and we always had cordial after dinner. And I know my sister and my brother and I loved creme de menthe. It was like a snowball, you know, scraped ice with the green and a little straw. So I was used to it, but I didn't know what the effect of alcohol was, because I would have claret maybe with my dinner, but there was a lot of ice and about 2 tablespoons of claret with a little water and some sugar. And eating it with your meals, you didn't feel. I think the first time, in fact, I know that I ever realized what alcohol would do for me was when I married. All my life, I didn't think that I was maladjusted, but I know now I was. In spite of coming from a home that was happy, I had a very indulgent father and everything, I was an extremely sensitive person and so self-conscious that I just hurt all over all the time. And the night that I married, I had a big church wedding. And I couldn't enjoy anything. I know they were saying this present is coming. I had this girl from St. Louis down for my wedding. She was staying with me. I was just scared to death that my dress wasn't going to do right, that the church wasn't going to be filled, that I'd fall flat on my face walking up the aisle. Well, in fact, I'm just frightened to death that I wasn't going to be a prima donna at the place that I should be a prima donna. And in those days of time, you know, I've been married 29 years. That's been before God. You didn't carry a little orchid up the aisle. You carried these great big bouquets like a funeral phrase. And you didn't have your picture taken until just before you went to the church. They're very kind brides now. I think they have their pictures taken 2 or 3 days ahead of time. Well, as self-conscious fellows, I have to be dressed about 2 or 3 hours before going to church and pose for these pictures, holding this huge, enormous thing. And I would love you all to see those pictures sometimes. I just, well, I look like somebody's digging me in the back of a sword. Well, about the time we were ready to go to church and they had finished, I really was in a terrific state. And my father looked at me, and he turned to the servant, and said, "Miss Esther is about to faint. Get her something to drink." Well, the servant he turned to was our old cook, and we had some waiters from the club there and all, and she was one of the guests at the wedding, you know, and she liked to drink. And poor lady went in the kitchen, and she came back with a water glass. And it was half full of time, and I drank it down. The church is just 3 blocks from the house. It was February, it was cold, and I got right into the car, and they drove me over. And as soon as I hit the church, they started the wedding. And baby, when I hit the that whiskey went right through me. Never have I felt so good. I walked up that aisle just like Mae West in her prime. But I walked up and then I walked through it over again. I don't think that I was conscious of what had happened to me. I think I was very happy. But I enjoyed it. But I think that it registered subconsciously. And do you know that that drink was wonderful for me. It was really medicinal that night. And it was on many occasions after that. I learned that it eased situations socially, and it helped us fine. But somewhere along the line, it backfired. And when I passed that line, I don't know, when something just went haywire, and I got to depend on it so I could do nothing without it. I think that it was in about 1931 that my drinking first caused comment. And yet, nobody was very perturbed about it, except my family. Because I decided after 7 years of marriage that I would divorce my husband. So, the night that I married, I must tell you, I was very hard-headed and quite a problem at home. And my mother told my husband, she said, "Thank goodness she's off my hands, but you sure have got your hands full." More than he really did. But anyhow, I decided to divorce him, and I did in July. It don't take a month to get one in Dallas, and I was living in Dallas at the time. And I went on home. Well, I really was free, white, oh, 21, and I had a time. I put my poor mother and father through the agonies of the damned. And finally, I couldn't stand living with them, watching everything I could do, and my husband was coming down, and I don't know, I had no feeling of security or anything else. It was a very asinine thing that I did when I did get the divorce, and finally I went back to Dallas and remarried. And we moved up to Custer, and that was when all the boys and Esther got drunk, and the wives didn't, and they would talk about it, and that went on for about 3 years, and then we moved back to Dallas. And then I started drinking. And Frank would come home day after day and finally passed out. Or he'd leave on a trip, and every time he came home, he passed out. So finally he said to me one morning, "Esther, why do you do this?" And I said, "Well, I don't know why. But I've been reading a lot about psychiatry, and I thought, well, maybe if I talk to a psychiatrist, he could find out some mental quirk and put me straight and then I could drink like a lady." So Frank said, "Well, if you'd like to talk to one, I will see a doctor and find out who to go to here." So Frank left with my problem and to get the doctor and all, so I got drunk. And when he came home, he had found a doctor that didn't want to take an alcoholic spray. He didn't call me back. That's because I was drinking too much. But that when he told the doctor that I wanted to talk to him, the doctor said, "Yeah." So I got drunker and drunker, and then I woke up in a booby hatch. You know, I had never been on the inside of an insane asylum, and I had really thought I was going to a private hospital. And I woke up in this bare room with nothing around me but these bars. There were no cigarettes. They wouldn't let me smoke, and they just treated me, well, like I was nuts. But of course, I didn't think I was. I know this. that right away I got furious, and I would not even talk to the doctor in the place. I wanted to come home. They kept me there. Well, I was supposed to stay a month, but they only kept me there 17 days. I know that I was terribly screwed up when I went in, but I came out much worse because I could not identify myself with the people that I was with, and there was no understanding, and I can't stand confinement, and it was just all these things, and I had hysterics on the 17th day for the first and only time in my life. So they let me go home, and the doctor let me go home on one condition. Because he asked me if I would cooperate with him after I went home, and that if I would have a trained nurse stay with me for at least 2 weeks. So all those conditions, regardless of the cost or anything else, I said yes. Well, I was so happy over getting home, and I changed this overnight. I was crazy about Dr. Hathaway. His name is Dr. Witt, and I've been calling him Dr. Hathaway. So I know that I said for years after, this was in 1936 or 37, that I cooperated with that man 100%. And that is how dishonest I was with myself. I know now that I answered all his questions and told him what I wanted to. And then I told him what I wanted to believe about myself. The questions he asked me that I didn't answer honestly, I thought were none of his damn business. And I could see no reason, or not a reason why they had any relation to this problem of getting drunk every now and then. So I know that it drove me further into this psychosis that I had, or whatever you want to call it. And I hated, deep down in my heart, I resented the fact that Frank had done this to me. And I just didn't know what way I was going. And life was pretty miserable. Well, about this time, Christmas, after I had been in Dr. Witt's place, after 6 months of being under his care, we just decided that there wasn't anything more to do. Every time I got drunk, he'd send me to a nursing home. He had better sense than send me back to that hospital. I think I disrupted the hospital. But anyhow, when we got back from Christmas, my husband had given me a cocker spaniel, who is my heart, and I think just as notorious in AA as I am now. You know, when you get so bad, even your dog won't have anything to do with you when you're drinking. It's pretty rough. But that's the way it got. And Frank had to go to New York. Well, because I had a dog, I just had a duplex, and I thought, if only we had a house, a duplex apartment isn't any place to raise a dog. So I went out and did the Samaritan treatment. He even had the people come out there and tell me what kind of a room I was going to have, and that he could come see me, and that my dog could come see me, you know, all the things that I couldn't have when I was in the food hat. So I took the Samaritan treatment. Well, I guess there are plenty of other graduates in Samaritan treatment in here. There are no easy ways to sober up, without a doubt, though. That's the most excruciating. It's the ERT treatment. So I took that 3 times, and that didn't work. Then there was a minister at the church. He tried to help me. There was a doctor in the congregation that was pretty interested in me, and he thought it was a vitamin deficiency. So I would go down to him for quite a few months, and have him shoot me full of all this stuff, menopause spilling. I'd go across the street to that little triangle drugstore, and I would take a glass of beer, 2 beers, then stop at the liquor store and get myself a pint, and I got home, and you know those vitamins just don't keep you sober. So that, finally in 1940, we went down to Houston, and my husband thought maybe a change of environment, a new town and everything else, I would be all right. We moved down in 1940, and that deal was my last. There was nothing else for us to try. We had tried everything. So the only thing that I could do would be call a doctor to help sober me up. I wouldn't go to hospitals because I wanted my dog there. And so I had to have a trained nurse. And the only time my dog had anything to do with me was when I had a hangover, you know, and I was so sick. And he'd come, and he's the only one that wouldn't have anything to do with me. Well, I don't know. It was a tragic thing. I have told you some of the funny things, but not much of the shame and degradation. I fell down and knocked out my front teeth. I dropped a 2-quart water bottle on my big toe. And I couldn't walk, had in a cast, and the doctor left it on 3 weeks longer than he should because he never found me sober, so he could take it off. He was afraid as soon as he took it off, I'd break it over again. On a dress call on fire by the bathroom here, and I didn't sit down 3 months. And it was one thing after another. So finally, one afternoon in April of 1941, I got as drunk as a skunk, and all of you that know me so well know that I do not walk straight sober. But you should see me when I'm drunk. And I was as drunk as I could be, and it was time for Nappy's afternoon walk. I had only a pair of denim slacks, and out I go, weaving with the dogs. And a patrol car passed. And they must have seen what condition I was in. I mean, they could tell what condition I was in. And decided to take me home. But when they picked me up, I must have gotten kind of sassy and told them they couldn't do that to Mrs. Elizotti. Because they took my dog home and they brought me to jail. Well, as I said before, I don't like to be fenced in. Those bars. You don't get hotel service. Now, I know they told my husband that they took me home. There wasn't anyone there, and I was in such terrible condition, and they didn't know what I would do to myself. And they realized there was no place for me. But for him to wait a while before he got me, because at that time, when they called him to come over for me, I was knocking a tin cup up against the wall. I wanted some cigarette service, of which I didn't get. So I was in just a few hours. But somewhere during that time, I remember going back on this bunk and just crying my eyes out. I think that is when I hit bottom. I didn't think that I could ever be, I just know that I went completely haywire on the inside. And yet still, we have this defensive front. So many people say, oh, he doesn't want to sober up, or she doesn't want to sober up. Stop and think of your behavior. My husband couldn't tell that I wanted to do something about it by looking at me. I was as defiant as anybody could be because I was too scared. I didn't know which way to turn. So when he came for me, as I walked down this gate, I could see him through these bars, and he was signing something. And I looked at him, and I said, don't you sign anything in this place. You know, I was going to sue the city of Houston for what they did to one boy like myself. But Frank turned around, and he looked at me, and he said, Esther, remember, you're in jail, not at home. And my friends, I never want anybody to look at me like that again, with the contempt and everything else that was in his face and voice. I think I read more contempt there than was really there, because just a week before, someone had sent him the Saturday Evening Post article on AA. And there was some glimmer in it of hope for him that there was something maybe else that I could try. But he was fighting to death to give it to me because I resented everything he said and did. So he waited another week or two. And I don't think I stayed sober hardly at all. He was out of town, and I know he'd gotten in this one night, and I was drunk. And the next morning, he came into my room, and he said, now, Esther, I'm not going to lecture you anymore, but he said, I want you to read this article. And he said, if you want to try this thing, I'll go along with you. But he said, if you don't, you will have to go home. He said, I cannot sit by and watch you destroy yourself anymore. So when he left, I thought, what is this crackpot thing? And I took 2 or 3 drinks so my eyes could focus. I don't see, and never will be able to see. And I could see this horrible picture, this awful drunk. I don't know if any of you ever saw it. He couldn't get the drink to his mouth. He had a towel around his hand. And he needed to shave. And I shuddered when I looked at that. But from the very first paragraph on, something happened to me. I realized that there were other people in this world who behaved and acted like I did, and that I was a sick person, and I was suffering from an actual disease that had a name and symptoms, just like diabetes or TB. That I wasn't immoral, I wasn't mad, I wasn't vicious. And I don't know, it was just with a feeling of relief. I wanted to know more about it. And with that, I think for the first time came the realization that there was something horribly, horribly wrong with me. I think up to that time, I was so completely baffled by my behavior that I never stopped to think. And so, as I said before, I don't know how or why AA worked. I know that it was the first meeting that ever reached me. And it reached me through this article. There was no one I could call. Anything I know, when Frank came home, I said, I want to try this thing. And he said, well, there's a post office box to write to in New York. And it's been very thrilling to hear so much about our service office during this convention. Because I am here just because of the service office in New York. And it's always meant an awful lot to me. Of course, we've grown so in the last 12 years that it's much bigger and a lot more different than it was then. But I wrote on a Saturday. In fact, I was shaking so I wanted my husband to write the letter, and he said no. He had gotten enough out of it. There was something that I had to do all by myself. So I wrote this letter in this very shaky handwriting, and in just 1 week, back came a letter with the literature from New York. They sent me just the regular little letter they send to everybody else. But along with it, Ruth Hart wrote a little note in longhand because she could read through the letter that it was written by me, that I really needed help, and a personal touch, I think, was something. Well, that was on Saturday, and my husband was leaving town on Sunday night, and he said, let's wait till I get back, and I will go with you to see this man. So, Frank left town, and Monday morning, I had been sober that whole week while waiting to hear about AA. And I wanted to try AA with my whole heart and soul. And I had learned an awful lot about myself in that one little article. And Monday morning, I was just feeling like $1 million when all you need is a half a pint of white swan, see? So I got half a pint of white swan. And at midnight that night, I called this number. And the man who started the group was in the hospital. And they didn't know what to do with me. They're afraid to send any of the men to see me, and there weren't any women. So they let me stew in my own juice. However, I stayed drunk from Monday till Friday. And I call that my spell in AA. I'm glad I had it then, because in spite of knowing that my drunkenness was a symptom of the things that were wrong with me, that's what the article told me, and that I could never drink again, I think I couldn't still yet face giving it up. And I was going to try. And I never wanted to get that last drink as long as I lived. It was one of the worst I ever had. It was the first time in my life that I could not get a lift out of what I was drinking. And so on Friday night, May 16th, at 6:05, I had a half a water glass of white swan gin. And with it is when I asked God to help me. And I wish I could tell all of you what I think and feel about AA. But it's something that I have experienced and I could never, ever put into words. I know that I only have a daily reprieve, that I must work at this as long as I live, but I do know that it is only working at it that I will stay sober and live a happy life. And there are words of Dr. Bobs and Bill that are with me all the time. You know, Dr. Bob says, love and service keep us dry. And Bill says, always we must remember that our first duty is face-to-face help to the alcoholic that still suffers. Dr. Bob tells us our program is simple and not to louse it up. It was the last thing I ever heard him say. And I think there are some of us that at times try to read mysteries and complexities into the steps. But they're not there. To me, AA is within the reach of every alcoholic. It can be achieved in any walk of life. Because the achievement is not ours, but God's. And if there's anyone here for the first time, I would just like to leave you with the feeling that there is no situation too difficult, none too desperate, no unhappiness too great to be overcome in this great life-saving movement of Alcoholics Anonymous. I don't know how much I can say either before I get all talked up, but Cole said,
one of the nicest things that I've heard in a long time when he said that all the boys here, or all the AAs here, felt like I belonged to them when I came in and before I moved up to Dallas, and how heartbroken they all were when I moved to Dallas and how lost. Because I know I felt I belonged to them much more than my husband. And I couldn't see what I was doing moving to Dallas. And I cried the whole way up. But it worked out a lot differently, we all know. Carl's been mighty sweet, telling you all some of the same things that I told him in the beginning. But the day I remember Carl most, it was the first day he came to us, and Hal Newman got him out of the city jail and called me about 7 o'clock in the morning and said, well, Esther, come down. I have a drunk for you to sit with all day. So I went down to the Rossonian and sat in Hal's room with Carl. And I used to ask more questions. If Roy is in the room, he will vouch for that. Dick Dallum and Gordon Sherwood and all of them said they never knew anyone that could ask the questions I could. And boy, I'd love to have a tape recording of that session with Carl. Me asking Carl questions and Carl asking me questions. I believe I got more out of talking to Carl than he got out of talking to me that day. I wish I could tell all of you all what I think and feel about AA. Of course, all I have to offer is my own story. But of course, you know, I am not physically able to do it. But I felt that if someone like God, who have gotten what I have gotten out of AA, didn't get up on their feet and at least let you see what it can and has done for me, well, I'd be a mighty sorry person. But I wish for each and every AA in this room, what I have found in AA. It's indescribable. It's something you have to experience for yourself. And I know there are a lot of newcomers, and we always say they are the most important, but I loved Grapevine this month because it talked about how important the older person was. Because I need AA today just as badly as the one that's been in here just 24 hours. Thank you.
I'm Esther. I'm an alcoholic, and through following the program of AA to the best of my ability, I have been dry since 1941. Well, I was just sitting there, catching my breath, and listening to the last speaker and talking about age and AA. And this woman, since I have been in AA, I've gotten more screwball notions than all we all put together. But I've never gotten that screwball notion that I'm cured. I know I'm as alcoholic today as I was the day I came in. And I may try anything else, but by God, I never want to try to take a drink again. Whenever I get up in front of a bunch of AAs, I would always like to say something immortal. To let you all know in some manner, shape, or form, what it means to me. But it's an impossible thing. I think that for any of us to realize what AA is, we have to experience it. We have to, as I say, do time in AA. I can tell any of you all how marvelous AA has been, and all, but it won't mean a damn thing to you if you haven't experienced it yourself. It's, not a museum of accomplishments. No matter what I have done or how many years or months or weeks I have been sober, the only thing in the world that counts is what I do today. It's a way of life that we have to live and practice. But the wonderful thing is that is the only way we find any happiness. If it was some way that, well, we graduate, what in the devil would we do? We couldn't have all this. And another thing that I thought today, I was having such a marvelous time last night and then down the ladder, that I know I'm getting old, because usually I never lost my voice until after 2 days of it, but I can't talk right now. I'm just as hoarse as I can be. But it's wonderful not to have to drink to make other people interesting. You know how men do this. You know, you always were with a bunch of boys until you had enough drinks to make them a little bit interesting. But seriously, I'm not going to say anything very much. I think in order to be a successful speaker, who is to say that you should stand up so everybody could see you, and you should speak up so everybody could hear you, and then you should sit down so everybody will like you. But I do want to just say this one thing, that I think that they were. Well, of course, there were so many things that appealed to me when I came in. But the two main things that meant so much to me was that I found that there were other people who acted and behaved as I did. And I found out that I was sick. It wasn't just that I was weak-willed or immoral or rotten or anything else. It was because I was a sick person. That there were other people that acted like I was, and that my disease had symptoms just like any other disease. And I think that with that, I was able to look at myself and it seemed like the weight of the world was lifted from my shoulders. Because I know that all of you will agree with me that alcoholism is the most lonely illness there is in the world. It cuts us off from everything and everybody. Thanks.
That I do, that there is no graduation point, because I don't almost bouquet, just like a funeral spray. You know, I was married so many years ago, they didn't have these little tiny orchids in your hands. I had to hold this great big thing. And for 2 hours, I sat up and left the dogs to try to take my picture. Well, I was self-conscious, and my face ached me, my body ached me, and I was about to faint. And just before I went to the church, my father came and could see the condition that I was in. He asked one of the servants, he said, "Miss Esther looks sick. Will you bring her a drink?" So Robert ran around kind of ruddy, and he came back with a half a water glass of whiskey. And down I drank. Well, the church was just about 4 blocks from the house. We got in the car. It was cold weather. We were at the church in no time, and I hit this long shirt, it was hot and jammed, and the alcohol started taking effect, and I ran up that aisle just like Mae West in her prime. Well, I know that consciously I didn't realize what had happened, but subconsciously it registered. Well, why didn't I know about this before? It just eased the whole situation from me. So after that, every time I went in place, I wanted a drink or two. And for quite a few years, I held it just beautifully. And when I passed the line from social into pathological drinking, I do not know. But I know even long before I passed that line that I was leaning on alcohol for something they didn't do for a normal person. So I think it was about 1932 that my drinking started causing comments, if you know what I mean. All the men and Esther got too much to drink. And finally, Esther got more than the men got to drink. And I thought it was because I was going with a rather true crowd. And I never did think that it was myself. Well, we were in Tulsa at the time. We moved back to Dallas in 1935. And it took me a while to sort of readjust myself and pick up old friends. And I was spending a lot of time at Rome and drinking alone. And so finally, my husband couldn't stand much more of it. And one morning he said, "Esther, why do you drink as much as you do?" He had come home the night before and I had been passed out. And I said, "Well, I don't know why. I think all of us wanted to know why we drink." Well, he said, "Would you like to see a doctor about it?" Well, I had been reading a lot about psychiatry, and I thought, well, that would be swell. That's what I would like to do. So finally said, "Well, I'll find out who to go see." So off he went with my alcoholic problem, so I got drunk. And then when he came home, he told me that he had seen the psychiatrist, and the psychiatrist wanted me to go to his private hospital, and be under observation for a week or two. And would I like that? Yes, I would like that. So, well, of course, we always get drunk on the way to cure. So I was drunk when I got to the private hospital. And so I didn't know I was in a psychiatric hospital, so I came out of my drunken stupor. I had never known what a psychiatric hospital was till I awakened in one. And I have never in all of my life experienced anything like that. But of course, the guy just got nowhere with me. I gave him the body and the money, and he did nothing for it. So I just figured that the party didn't work. The year after that, my husband had to go to New York, and I just got a dog, and I wanted a new house. I thought I shouldn't keep a dog in the apartment. Well, Frank said, I cannot go to New York and leave you in a house. I don't know what will happen. He said, I'll get the house for you if your father will come stay with you while I'm in New York. So my father came to stay with me. I got a new house, a new fur coat. I have my new dog. And my daddy came, and I loved my daddy. And everything was going to be swell. And Frank went to New York, and I got drunk. So my father taught me into taking a lip cure. Well, that is the matter. You know, the earth treatment. There's no easy way to get sober, but that's the most excruciating. Well, I won't go into those details. I went through that 3 times, and that didn't work. And then finally, my minister tried to work with me. Well, I know that the doctor, the psychiatrist, was looking on me as a crazy patient. I know that when I was in there with these other nuts, I couldn't identify myself with him. And when my minister was very nice and very sweet to me, I felt that all along he was looking down his nose at me, that he didn't understand, which he didn't. And finally in 1940, we moved down to Houston. By that time, we had just worn out everybody. I had worn out more doctors coming for hangovers. When we got down to Houston, there was nothing else to do except get a doctor and a hospital nurse in sobering me up. Well, I did one thing after another. I fell out of bed, not my two front feet loose. I caught my dress on fire, and I didn't sit down for 3 months. I got the Newport water bottle on my big toe and had compound fracture. The doctor had to leave the cast on 6 weeks longer than usual. So he never found me sober enough to take it off. He was afraid to take it off. I was broken. It was one thing after another. And finally, one afternoon, about 3 or 4 o'clock, I was taking my gloves for a walk. I was just as drunk as I could be. And all of you who know me know that I do not walk straight sober, which you should see me when I am drunk. So I was leading down the street in Houston when a cruising car passed. So they chased me out. They could see the condition I was in with my dog, and I guess they were going to take me home. But I must have gotten kind of snotty and said, you can't do this, Mrs. Elizalde, because they took the dog home and they took me to jail. Don't fence me in ever again. But you don't get hotel service in those places. I didn't have my cigarettes with me. I had nothing but a pair of German slacks on. So I started being this pink cup. I wanted the jailer to come and bring me some cigarettes and a few other things. And I beat that cup. It was about that time that my husband arrived. Well, they had called him, and he was frightened to death. He didn't know what I was in. He thought that I had been pushed up for drunken driving. I think he was vastly relieved when he found out it was just a plain drunk charge. But when he got there, I was going through this meeting of the tin cup business. So they told him they didn't think it was any place for me. I didn't know that, though. And they told him to come back to me later, that they thought it would be good for me to cool off for a couple hours. When he came back and got me, about 7, I guess it was, and as the door took me along the corridor, and they had this jail, this barred gate. As he was opening that gate, my husband had paid the fine and was fining something at this window. And I looked over at him and I said, "Don't you find anything in this place? I was going to sue that city, you know, for putting me in the jail." And he came around and he looked at me and he said, "Esther, remember you're in jail, not at home." And I tell you, I never want anyone to look at me like that again. It was shortly after that, just about a week, that Frank handed me the Saturday Evening Post article on Alcoholics Anonymous. It was in the March 1st issue of 1941. He had had it for a couple of months. He was frightened to death to give it to me, because everything he seemed to do, I resented. But he gave it to me at the right time. I had not stayed sober at all after I got out of jail. I could not live with myself. I was consumed with fear every time the doorbell rang, the phone rang. I just didn't know where I was going or what I was doing. So one morning before he left, he came in my room and he said, "I'm not going to lecture you. I'm not going to do anything, but I want you to read this article." He said, "If you, after reading this, if you want to try this method," he said, "I am willing to go along with you." He said, "If you don't, you will have to go back home." He said, "I cannot sit by and watch you destroy yourself any longer." So when he left, I was, just like this, my eyes, I don't see good. I need to see, and I was all sober and drunk, my eyes won't focus. So I had to take it. I had to take a few drinks, and I read what AA had to say with the most marvelous feeling of relief. I found out that I was a sick person. I wasn't mad or vicious. I was suffering from an actual disease that had a name and symptoms, just like diabetes or TB. And when I found that out, I could accept myself in that light. I could never identify myself as a crazy person in the psychopathic hospital or the criminal in jail. But I was sick, and I felt sick. And with that came a strong desire and a willingness to do something about myself. Thank you.
Thanks for listening. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. Sobercast is ad-free, and we'd like your help in order to keep it that way. So if you'd like to help us be self-supporting by pledging $1 or $2 a month, visit Sobercast.com and look for the donate links. Thank you very much.